And then I don't know how much you might want to talk about. You tell me when you're ready.
How much time do we have? How long do you think this will go?
Probably an hour.
Okay.
Is that
no, that's fine. I've got that much time. Are you going to edit something down at some point, or are you going to have this long, long, long thing?
For the archive, it'll just be
the whole thing.
For what we use, like for promos and stuff, it'll be
chunks of it. Yeah. Cool.
Okay. And Terry, if you have questions that you want to be sure to get in, just bring them to me and put it down here, you know, as we go through. Okay. If you need more information or specifics, okay, you just tell me when. Okay, PCDC, are you willing to talk about
sure.
that to some extent? Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, and did you serve on the CAMPO board?
I'm still the executive. I'm on the executive committee.
The importance of that.
Okay, and I'm on CAPCOG as well. I'm on the executive commission.
How we have to get to a certain level. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then we might talk about ETJ.
Okay.
And the value of that.
Whenever you are.
Good morning, Mayor Coleman. We're very pleased you could be with us for the interview. We're celebrating the city's 50th anniversary, so we want to capture some of the stories over the past decades. Tell us your name and where you were born.
It's Mayor Jeff Coleman. I was born in Amarillo, Texas in 1966.
Well, and what is your present role in the city?
I'm the mayor of Pflugerville.
Okay. So the next question is somewhat, what were you doing in 1965? And you just mentioned that you hadn't gone on planet
Correct.
Earth at that time, and that was when the city was founded.
That's right. My parents were actually married in 1965.
Okay, cool. All right, so tell us your first impression of when you came to Pflugerville.
Well, the very first time I remember anything about Pflugerville was in 1997. I was being transferred with my company from Corpus Christi, Texas, up to Central Texas, and we were looking at houses. And I'd been told to stay away from Travis County, so we didn't look at any houses in Travis County. Looked all in Williamson County, but I remember looking off to the right or looking down to the east and just seeing a sea of rooftops and wondering what that was, and boy, that must be a booming area just because you could see nothing but rooftops as far as you could see.
And then you eventually decided to come to Pflugerville with your family, and tell us about that.
Correct. Well, in March of 2000, I opened up a State Farm Insurance independently owned agency and was still commuting from the Round Rock area and really wanted to be a part of the community. And so my family and I started looking for a home. In April of 2001, we purchased a house in the Springbrook subdivision so that I could be close to my work and so that my kids could go to a local neighborhood school. I had gone to something like 8 different schools through my education, first through 12th grade, and I wanted my children to have a little bit more stability than I had. And so getting into an area with a great school system was something that was important to us.
How did you get involved in city government?
I took a different track than most people take. I was a political science major in college, and so politics is something that always interested me. But as I just said, I started a business in 2000 and was busy growing that business and getting it to the level it needed to be. Between 2000 and 2006, I was the president of a youth sports organization in Austin. And that really was my trial by fire for volunteerism. If you can run a sports league dealing with people's children, you can run about anything. And so I was in Pflugerville. I was somewhat working with the Chamber of Commerce. I was one of those people who at night would watch the city council meetings on Channel 10 just because it interested me. And we were in an interesting time in the history of Pflugerville at that time. We had a city government that we had a newly elected mayor. She did not, unfortunately, have the support of many members on the council, and it was somewhat dysfunctional. And I started to become worried about the direction of the city. And at first, it was a very selfish worry because I had a business that I needed Pflugerville to be economically healthy and viable for the next 30 years. And I was worried that our current leadership was moving us in a direction of dysfunctionality that was not going to create the economic stability that I needed for my business and for my family and to do what we all want to do, which is prosper and have a good, comfortable life. So in November of 2006, I was approached by some of the members of the current council and stating that they were looking for someone to run for mayor. That was coming from the business community. At first, I laughed it off and said, I've not done anything in the city, so why would I be a good fit for going straight to mayor? And took the next number of months to at least look at it and research more. I paid a lot of attention to how the council was and how the council was run. I read the charter and determined exactly what was needed from a mayor, and I looked at where Pflugerville was as a community, and I'm a fairly self-aware person. In other words, I know what my strengths are, and I know what my weaknesses are. And when I compared my strengths to what I felt like Pflugerville needed, coming up into a very important time in our history, the more I thought about it, the more I thought that my strengths fit the position of mayor pretty well. So I decided in November, I guess, or December of 2006, that I was going to give this a shot and see what would happen. I had the support of a number of members on council, and they were really looking for someone who was not part of the political establishment within Pflugerville and who was really coming in with a fresh view and a fresh perspective. And so it worked well on a number of fronts. I had the support of a number of members of the council. I had some support, and I had a lot of support in the business community because I was one of theirs in the local business community. And so we started the campaign and decided we were going to give it a shot. About that time, the incumbent decided that she was not going to run for re-election due to family issues. And so it opened up a wonderful time for kind of a fun campaign. And then in May of 2007, I was elected mayor of Pflugerville and have been reelected twice without opponents both times, which I hope means that enough people feel like I'm doing a good job that they don't need to step in and try to change direction.
Tell us about when you first came, some of the business owners and the markets that were available locally.
Markets meaning what, establishments that you could shop at.
Merchandise.
Yeah.
What would you go shopping at that particular place for?
You know, when I moved here in 2001, the new HEB on 685 had just opened, and that was there was an Albertsons on Pecan that I always joked was the biggest convenience store in the world, because you never saw anybody go in there and buy more than three or four or five items. HEB was very popular, but from a retail perspective, that was the limit. If you wanted more than groceries and what you could buy at an HEB or an Albertsons, there was very few offerings that you could purchase. If you needed to go to the hardware store, you could go to Gaddy's and get your items at Gaddy's from a hardware perspective. But if you needed clothing, those sorts of things, you know, electronics, there was really nothing in Pflugerville at that point to do. And you know, since I've been mayor, I've thought a lot about why that was. Why were we a town at that point of 35 or 40,000 people, and if you include our ETJ, 45,000 people, why did we have so few retail establishments, and why was our commercial tax base and our commercial base as stunted as it was? And I really think it has to do with a little bit of Pflugerville's history. You know, I think we had a history as a very, very rural community, very farming community, and the people who lived here, that's what they wanted to be, and that's what they were concerned with. And then you had Austin, just to the south of us, who was obviously much more sophisticated than we were. And you had Round Rock to the north, which was going through a huge boom because of Dale and everything that was happening there. And Pflugerville was in the middle with no access to I-35, no city limit access to I-35. And I think we just got kind of left out of that boom that was occurring in the 90s and the early 2000s. And that was one of the things when I was looking at mayor that I really wanted to work to change, because where I lived, if you wanted to go buy a TV, it was at a minimum a 15-minute drive, and if you wanted to try to get to the mall, it was a 45-minute drive, and there was just nothing, there was nothing fun or convenient about that.
As mayor, you then, with this vision, what did you have to put in place, the workings to make happen your vision to bring in businesses and to change that paradigm?
You know, part of it was purely timing, that Pflugerville was ready. SH-130 and SH-45 were completed within a year of me being elected mayor, which opened up which created a lot of excitement. Actually, just before I was elected, the city council was able to enter an agreement with a developer that eventually became Stonehill Town Center. And so part of it was just pure timing, but that was going to create a part of it. But the quite frankly, the big change that needed to occur, and that was well beyond timing, and that was myself and the city council members' role. And I really think because we were all united is the reason it occurred, is it still is occurring, and that is a perception change had to occur for what Pflugerville was and what Pflugerville is. There was a perception in all of Central Texas that Pflugerville was still rural, that Pflugerville was lower income, and that Pflugerville was never going to be anything more than a bedroom community for the city of Austin. I remember having a conversation with an engineer from West Austin that was very involved in the sports league I was a president of. When I first told him I was going to run for mayor, and we were I don't remember exactly what we were talking about, but we were talking about some sort of a development. And he was stunned that anybody would consider going to Pflugerville to grow their business. And y'all can accommodate that, was kind of his response. And I was offended by that because it's where I live, and I know what Pflugerville is. And Pflugerville is an incredible place. And so, you know, that was another one of those catalysts that really made me think we've got to change the perception of what Pflugerville is before the rest of Central Texas and beyond that will take us seriously as a player in Central Texas. I'll never forget when SH-130 opened. I was sitting in the city limits of Pflugerville for the grand opening. And I was there with the mayor of Hutto, Georgetown, Manor, and Austin, I believe. And I was there with Darrell White, who was one of our city councilmen at the time, and I believe Victor Gonzalez was there. And we were sitting in the audience, and all the other dignitaries had a special place that they had been put. And so as they're going through the elected officials that were in attendance, remember, we're in the city limits of Pflugerville, and they didn't mention anyone from the city of Pflugerville. And that offended me highly, that they would come into my community on a road that was going to bring prosperity to my community. And quite frankly, Pflugerville was the only city along SH-130 that was ready to develop. We had done our homework. We had the zoning in place. We knew what the infrastructure needs were. Hutto, Manor, Georgetown, none of them had done everything that we had done. And to not be recognized really showed me what the establishment of Central Texas thought about Pflugerville. And I vowed then that we were going to change that. And we were going to do the things necessary to change that perception of Pflugerville. And luckily, I had a very united council that got behind that vision. And we worked very hard to start changing that perception. And here we are 6-7 years later, And Pflugerville is now, you know, obviously one of the quote-unquote players, but beyond that, one of the first organizations to be talked about. If someone's coming in to Central Texas from a business perspective, they are definitely going to be told what's going on in Pflugerville, and they are going to look at Pflugerville. We may not get the business, but we're in the discussions. And 7 years ago, that was not occurring.
SH-130 was certainly the economic engine of the present time.
Mm-hmm.
And historically, we can go back to 1904 in this same community when the MKT, Missouri-Kansas-Texas Railroad, came through. And that was what spurred the building of present downtown Pflugerville.
Mm-hmm.
And it took the leaders at that time to build the buildings and to make things happen. So back to the present, how did you, as the city, work with developing your infrastructure, utilities, etc., through your councils and our commissions to be ready for things to start popping?
Okay. Well, there's a couple of different things that are going. Number one was Stonehill Town Center, which was the deal that was done just before I was elected. But I'm happy to say that I remember one of my very first phone calls after I was elected was the developer. And I don't remember the specific issue, but there was something had come up, and he said, "Jeff, if this happens, it will kill this deal." And so, you know, we spent the next month trying to make sure whatever that issue was didn't occur, because I could see that Stonehill Town Center had to happen. That particular development, the developers came to us. They said, "Listen, we want to partner with you, but you have to understand Pflugerville, for all the reasons I just described a few minutes ago, is a risky venture for us. And we need some help making our numbers work." Well, the city looked at it and made a decision that there were some roads through Stonehill that could actually be public roads. And so we entered a contract with the developer for them to build those roads, but that we would then turn around and reimburse them for the cost of building those roads. So very uniquely, we created something that you don't see in typical private developments, which is the roads within Stonehill Town Center are all public roads. And that was the first step for the city to move into creating incentives in order to bring businesses into town.
At that point, was Stonehill in the city limits?
Yes, ma'am.
The property?
Yeah, no, it was absolutely.
The ETJ had gone out that
point. The ETJ was well past that at that point. And so, no, we couldn't have done it. We couldn't have done the incentives we did if it had not been in the city limits. That then created an additional, you know, we understood then the power of incentives, and we understood that at least for a while, Pflugerville was going to have to be more aggressive in attracting businesses and using incentives than most other municipalities. Once again, going back to our historical issue of being misperceived and what our community was. And so we are very aggressive in going out and looking for businesses, and we do that pretty unapologetically. We understand that we're in a unique time and a unique place, and that if we want to bring the tax burden for municipal services off of the backs of citizens and onto a larger, more expanded tax base, we have to be aggressive. When I was elected, as I recall, our ad valorem tax receipts accounted for 72 or 73% of our budget. We're down to 48 or 49%. For the first time ever is Pflugerville been under 50%. That's a win for the citizens of the city of Pflugerville. They don't always understand that. They think we're just giving away money. They don't understand how much we've been able to expand that tax base, which has been a real benefit. After Stonehill, kind of the next big development that the city started to develop with the partnership of our development corporation, which is the 130 Commerce Center, which is at the corner of Pecan and SH-130. And that, I'll never forget, our economic developer at the time, our president, Randy Duncan at the time, came to me and said, "Listen, we've got an idea to buy 190 acres of land because we feel like we can get it for a good price, and that we can turn around and we can start being the developer. We then have control of the price of the land, which is the biggest cost in many instances for a business wanting to come to town. And so we can do some creative incentives. And that must have been in 2009, 2010, somewhere in there. And since that time, today we have just over 1 million square feet of industrial flex space, most of which is filled. We just completed a 250,000 square foot warehouse for FedEx, which is, interestingly enough, we're now talking to other distributors that are similar to FedEx in an attempt to, they like what they are seeing. That would be on adjoining land. It would not be on the Development Corporation land. And so that has now become the second economic engine. We have Stonehill Town Center, which from a retail standpoint is our economic engine. Then we have SH 130 that is becoming our industrial warehouse kind of area. We have everything from the corporate headquarters of Community Impact there, Tracking Point, which is a precision scope, a precision guided scope manufacturer. Headquarters are there. So we have industrial, we have some warehousing, we have some corporate offices right there. And so we now have taken it in the last 5 years from raw land that was not even being farmed. It was truly, from that perspective, useless land, and has now turned it into an area where the city, the average city taxpayer, is receiving benefit because of the value that we've put there. Not to mention, one of the things we've heard over and over and over again is that Pflugerville did not have a daytime population because we were a traditional bedroom community. Our workers left town and they went to Austin or Round Rock or Cedar Park or Buter or wherever to work. 130 Commerce Center is changing that. We have 400 or 500 workers out there right now. We think over the next 5 years there'll be 2,000 workers on that one corner, which is going to help us continue to create to create that growth and daytime population. One of the other things I always like to talk a little bit about when I'm in this subject is cities don't always do incentives just for the economic benefit to the city or to the resident. There are times you make a decision based on it being a quality of life issue for your citizens. And an example of that is Cinemark theaters. The Stonehill Town Center developers were trying to get a theater at Stonehill, and they had been courting Cinemark, and they came to the city and said, we can't get them to do this. They just think that the area is too green and that it's 3 to 5 years before y'all will get a theater. Well, I personally did not think that was acceptable. I live in Northeast Pflugerville, and for me to go to a theater was once again a 15-minute to a 30-minute drive. And that was not a good quality of life. If you're someone who likes going to the movies, that was just not a convenient way to go. And so the city manager and myself and some of the city council, we started thinking about what can we do to get Cinemark to come to town. And it ends up being a long story, but what we were able to do is we thought they would be more successful than they thought. And so we said, okay, if that's the case, if we offer you some tax breaks, is that enough to get you to come to town? And we're going to limit those to a certain dollar limit because we think you're going to get that back dramatically faster than you think you're going to get that back. We ended up getting that deal done. We were right. They were wrong. They have done much better than they anticipated being, and quite frankly, right now are considering expanding a half dozen years prior to their plan. But the people who won was not the city coffers, because it doesn't bring that much money in.
The people who won were the citizens of Pflugerville who now can drive 3, 4, 5 minutes to go to a movie as opposed to driving as far as they were. So it's a quality of life issue. So we can use incentives not only for those real big developments that are game changers, like Pflugerville Crossing that we just announced. We can also do it for very small things just to make the everyday life of the everyday citizen a little nicer.
So we have retail shopping, we have employment opportunities, and a third thing, I believe, again, falls into the quality of life, but providing fun for our citizens, and you may talk about that, including Lake Pflugerville and business opportunities.
Well, you know, Lake Pflugerville opened in 2005, I believe. And so it was before I was elected, it was before I was really, I was paying attention, but I wasn't intimately involved. But I do remember there was a big controversy when the city council made the decision to sell the bonds to build Lake Pflugerville. And many long-term residents of Pflugerville thought that it was going to be a boondoggle and that we were going to spend an incredible amount of money and get nothing for it, and that it was going to raise our rates dramatically, which it did. And they were very frustrated by it. Well, those council people that were on that council were, in my mind, visionaries. They saw where we were going and where the water issues in Pflugerville and Central Texas were going, and realized that we needed a much more reliable water source. And they were doing it for a water source. And as far as I can tell, they never really thought that it was going to be much more than that. Well, what it has become is a hub of activity for not only our citizens, but for citizens in all of Central Texas. The reservoir has a 3-mile or a 5K lap around it. It has incredible access to the back roads of Pflugerville and East Pflugerville. And so what it has become is the premier triathlete training spot in Central Texas. If you want to train for a triathlon, at some point during your training, you're going to be in Pflugerville, and you're going to be at Lake Pflugerville to do it. So it became a huge amenity and created those fun opportunities there. On top of that, if you go to Lake Pflugerville any day of the week, May through September, you're going to find the beach that we've built full of people enjoying themselves, having fun. You're going to find people walking their dogs around the track. You're going to find other people biking, other people running. It has truly become an amenity that the city did not expect, and has become a wonderful piece of Pflugerville, and we're becoming known for this little reservoir just because it works, and it's something that the area needed.
And with the covered buildings, it's a destination for birthday parties or family gatherings. And
it is.
Even the July 4th fireworks.
Correct. Well, 5 years ago, we started the firework festival, and once again, it has become one of the places in Pflugerville that we are being known for. And we have it's once again this beautiful venue. We can do an all-day celebration. It's not like in Austin where you leave the house at 6 and try to find a parking place to where you can see it, and then you turn around and leave as soon as it's over. People come to Lake Pflugerville to spend all day long on July 4th. And they get there with their tents and their ice chest and their grills, and they spend all day playing in the water and enjoying themselves. A lot of times there's windsurfers, so they have entertainment to watch. The city has they put a band out. And so it has created this atmosphere. And remember, where we first started this conversation is everything the city is doing right now is very calculated and very designed to increase the stature of Pflugerville in Central Texas, because we understand that we will not develop the wealth for our community that is needed and necessary until that perception changes. And all of these things work lockstep together. the creating the retail environment, the creating the business environment, the creating the fun, all of them are pieces of a puzzle that are going to create an opportunity where our city government can provide better service for less money off of the residential taxpayer.
Part of that also is our extensive trail system and the volunteers who have helped to build the fishing piers and are to plant trees along the trails.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've said many times that our trail system is an unknown jewel within Central Texas. And in my mind, it rivals Town Lake. It is extensive. It's beautiful. At some point, you're walking along almost virgin creek beds to where nothing's ever happened, and you can't see any residential development. You can't see any commercial development. You're in the wild while you're in the middle of this 55,000-person town. It's very long, so for people who want to stay in shape and get exercise, between Lake Pflugerville and our trail system, it is just, it is wonderful. I'm so proud of our citizens for passing a bond this last November to actually really complete our trail system. They've put $1 million to go in, and we have some gaps, and fix those gaps and get them to a place where it is going to be just perfect. So we work real hard to keep that done. You know, other fun things we have in the city is we have an entertainment venue coming that's going to be a bowling alley and birthday party place for kids to come. And you know, what's interesting is, you know, bowling, I think, lost favor through the 90s and the 2000s, and you didn't hear it much talked about except for bowling parties. But my neighborhood is so excited about this new bowling alley coming to town, an entertainment center, because it's truly an entertainment venue. It'll have laser tag and it'll have a restaurant and a bar and all that. But they're all talking about, well, let's get a league from this street or from this neighborhood or not a league, but a team. And so people are really excited. And once again, it is going to draw people in from out of town. Hawaiian Falls, people have asked me many, many times, why in the world did the city allow a water park to come into town and take that piece of property? And, you know, I was doing a meeting one time, and it was about Hawaiian Falls. It was one of their grand openings. And we had a room of probably 250 people. And I stood at the podium in the front, and I started off by saying, okay, everybody wants to know, why did the city of Pflugerville want a water park? And I said, by a show of hands, if you don't live or work in the city of Pflugerville, can you please raise your hand? 75% of the room raised their hand. I said, that's the reason why the city wanted this development, because it is bringing in approximately 200,000 people a year into Pflugerville. We are now a destination that we were never a destination before. And those folks get to come into Pflugerville, see what kind of an incredible community we have. They're spending their money from different areas of Central Texas, and then they go home. So we get the benefit of them being in town, but we don't have to provide services for them. And that is a win, once again, for our citizens.
I'm going to talk a little bit about the Metro Park, the county park it's been here for a while, mm-hmm. but again, people would come in, use it, and leave. And now Pflugerville has a lot to offer them, and they're seeing those things where they will.
Correct. Well, you know, and Pflugerville has never been a destination. There was no, if you didn't need to come to Pflugerville because you worked here or lived here, you didn't come to Pflugerville. With very few exceptions. I say never. I guess in the 1900s, when we had the rail going through town, there was some destination appeal to it. But in the last 50 years, 40 years, since the city's been involved, it really hasn't been a destination. And that's changing. People are coming to Pflugerville because we have things to offer them that other parts of the Austin metropolitan area doesn't have. And that's a neat thing to see.
I think that's accurate because I think that when the rail lines came through, there were like three hotels in town. Mm-hmm. But then in the 50s, during the severe drought and the economic downturn and the rails were taken up, that's when things went pretty slim in the town.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to shift to your role as mayor and talk about some of your interesting meetings that you've had, or maybe constituents that call with whatever strange things have happened in your role as mayor.
You know, those things haven't happened as often as I hear other politicians talk about. And I don't know if it's because, I don't know why it is. You know, I hear politicians talk about they can't go to HEB because they get bugged. And that stuff never happens to me. I don't know if it's because Pflugervillians are just very respectful of our time. I'm not exactly sure what it is. But we've obviously had some of those issues. Just this morning, I was responding to an email from someone who's upset about something. And he was upset at our city staff because our city staff, he said they didn't respond. And I was looking at the email where they had responded. And I get very protective of our city staff because they do a great job. We ask them to do a lot. And so I get protective of that. Specifically, let me think about some specific meetings or occurrences that have happened. You know, I think some of the, maybe I'm just a kind of a political junkie or nerd, but some of my most fun city council meetings we've had are when the room is full and people are mad about something, most of the time because they don't understand what it is that's occurring. But I love the process. I love the fact that people feel like they can come in and they can talk to their elected representatives and get action. Sometimes we change our minds, sometimes we don't. Sometimes we think it's going the right direction and we're going to continue with it. But residents can have a real effect. I remember when the Pfluger property right across the street from HEB, when there was a big development that was scheduled for that, and fortunately or unfortunately, depending on your perspective, that fell through because of the economic downturn in 2008. But we had a room full of people, and they were upset with the initial ideas the developers had. And that process worked, because at the end of the process, what we granted the developers was much different than what they had originally asked for and much closer to what the residents wanted, because you had citizens that actually came into the meeting, talked to their elected representatives, and were able to effectuate change. And that's what the process is supposed to be about. Quite frankly, that's the reason why the state and the national process doesn't work many times, is because there's not direct access from the citizen to the leader. In Pflugerville, you've got that. You can stop me at HEB and ask me any question, and I'm gonna be there, and I'm a very everyday person, and the rest of the council's the same way. And so there's a lot of those little meetings that happen that actually end up changing something.
I go back to when Walmart came to Pflugerville, mm-hmm. and there was quite a bit of discussion on just the exterior presentation of the building that the citizens worked through to make it their town.
Correct. And that was one of the first Walmarts that had that facade, and that Walmart realized that communities did not want just a big blue box put down in their community. And so it has some character. Is it perfect? Probably not. But is it better than just a big blue box? Absolutely.
The city council chambers started in the First State Bank building on the corner, and then they went to the chamber building, and now we're at this location. And in the last period of time, it certainly has become a beautiful place. So mm-hmm. talk about how the chamber got to be
what it is. Well, I'll never forget probably my very first meeting when I came into council. I remember going into our conference room, and we had conference chairs that were from at least the 70s. They were still kind of a mustard yellow. The leather on the tops were broken and cracked. And I went to the city manager and remember, once again, my entire campaign was predicated on the fact that we had to change direction, we had to change perception. I went to the city manager and I said, please go find some new chairs. He said, we don't have any money. And I said, we've got enough money to replace 8 chairs. Because we're asking people to come into our community and negotiate with us around this table. And if we think we're poor, they think we're poor. And we have to change that perception. And we've done that throughout the entire City Hall complex. And I want to again give kudos to our city manager and his staff, because they picked up on that vision. And many times they're thinking, they're doing their job, which is, we are elected representatives and we all have real jobs. And we all spend 40 or 50 hours a week doing those jobs that make us money because we volunteer for the city. Our city staff, we expect them to be thinking 40 or 50 hours a week about what's best for the city. And this room, for an example, we hired a wonderful public information officer. And I don't know exactly how the process occurred. I don't know if she was told to fix the building or if she just walked in and went, oh my word, we need to fix the building. But it wasn't very long after Terry was in her position that we started seeing significant changes in the council chambers. And you know, when I was first elected, I remember going to a city council meeting in the city of Hutto. And I came back and told our city manager, I'm embarrassed by our city council chambers when I compare it to other municipalities very close to us. They took that in, they heard the critique. They did not get defensive. They started changing things. And now, yeah, we've got a very nice area with this beautiful mural right behind me. And once again, the council didn't tell anybody on staff, go put a mural that we can do this kind of stuff in. They care about their jobs and they care about our community. And they work hard to make it nice. And we've done that within the constraints of money that we have. They've done that and they're going to continue doing that.
Your present office is in Old Town, downtown Pflugerville. Could you tell us about the building that you presently office from?
Oh, absolutely. It's got a very neat story. It's 111 East Main. It is the oldest commercial building in Pflugerville. The bank at the corner of Railroad and Main, the building itself, having a building on that location, was actually slightly older by 2 or 3 years, but that original structure burned down, and my building did not. And so from that perspective, it's the oldest freestanding building left in the city. It was originally the Pflugerville Mercantile Company, and I've talked to a lot of Pflugerville residents from that time, and they remember going and getting their dry goods specifically on my side of the building. There was a sister building built right next to it that burned down in the big downtown fire, and I believe it was 1974, and that was where the groceries were. And so the two buildings were joined, and it was a gathering place for Pflugerville, and as any mercantile would be at any point in history, people came together to buy their needs. But also to talk and to meet friends and to socialize and to gossip and to do everything that folks did back then. And so it has just an incredible history. I remember when I bought the building in 2013, and I bought the lot next to it that once again had at one point been a building and had, after the fire, they had just basically cleared it and put a concrete parking lot on it instead of rebuilding a building. And I wanted to put a patio on it. And so we went in and we pulled the concrete up. And when we did that, you could still smell fire or smoke from a fire that had occurred 40 years earlier. It was the most amazing thing. There was a smell of smoke in the air that day. And it was just amazing. There was burned wood and brick and all kinds of stuff under that. And so from a historical standpoint, it was a very neat thing to do. And the building is still doing that. I office out of a State Farm agency, just last week I had somebody walk in and said, this has to be the coolest office I've ever seen. So it's very unique. It's very different. It's hard to keep cool in the summer and warm in the winter, but other than that, we just love the building.
Also, being a State Farm agent, you had the opportunity to follow some of our school teams to the state championships, mm-hmm. because State Farm usually sponsors those. Mm-hmm. Tell us about the two incidences in, I think, the final state final at the Alamo Dome, as well as the state basketball tournament.
Yeah, well, I'm a big football fan, not as big a basketball fan, so I kind of got into that late. But it was fun watching the Panthers in 2007 make that run to the state championship. And, of course, once again, I was the brand new mayor. And when they made it to the state championship game in the Alamo Dome, it was a neat experience to be there, not only as the mayor, but because State Farm was the primary sponsor of the game that year. I was there as the State Farm agent. State Farm always asked their local agents to attend those kind of things. So I had two hats on that day. And it was neat standing on the floor of the Alamo Dome and being able to talk about the two things I truly love the most, and the two things that have made the most impact in my life, my career obviously, but also the city that I moved to in 2001 and grew to love, and then decided I wanted to help provide vision for the future for. So it was a neat experience. The basketball game was kind of the same surreal experience. You're down there right on the floor of the basketball stadium watching those young women play their hearts out for that state championship. It's a lot of fun.
You mentioned that you were involved in youth sports, and as our city has grown, we have families that come. And what are the opportunities for youth leagues and children to participate in sports at an early age here in Pflugerville?
Well, they have a lot of opportunity, although I'm not satisfied with that opportunity. It's one of the things I've been most frustrated with the last couple of years. We have not done a good job of keeping up with that growth. And there's a lot of reasons for that. And I don't think anybody's at fault for it. I think it's just one of the outcomes of a community growing as fast as we are. We have an incredible youth recreation sports league called the Pflugerville Area Soccer League. And it has, over 1,000 children, I believe, that play in it. So they have a piece of property at the Wells Point Park off of Heather Wild, and they do a great job with it, and it is done a very, very good job. We have two select soccer leagues beyond Paisel that are playing in town. So that's, soccer is the fastest growing sport in the United States. And so that's just a natural outcome of that. Beyond that, we have Pflugerville Little League that the school district has done such a good job of allowing them to use that land for, 2 decades. We have some leagues through our recreation department. We have great swimming teams at our local city parks, and so they do that. And then there's football spread through all the community. So we have a lot of opportunity. What we've not done a good job of is keeping up with the facilities. And once again, I'm very proud of our citizens for understanding that. One of the things I really wanted to pass this last year in the bond election was a youth sports facility. And they did. They approved $11.5 million to go towards youth sports facility. And so sometime in the next 24 months, we should have a park somewhere between 100 and 200 acres with soccer fields and new baseball fields and a new softball field and football fields, a lot of area that is going to be brand new, in great shape, and I'm just really excited. And it's going to be one of the things, I won't be mayor when it opens, but I'll be there at the grand opening, and I'll be very proud for whoever is mayor as they're cutting that ribbon, because it is going to be one of the kind of crowning achievements that we recognized a problem, and the citizens said, yes, that is a problem, we're going to fix it. And I can't wait till it's fixed.
Because of the marketing of the city and the leadership of the city, Pflugerville has been recognized nationally on quality of life issues, our destination for people to come to live. Talk about those awards recognized.
Yeah, I have a plaque in my office that says that we're the 20th, according to Money Magazine, that the 20th best city in the United States to live in. Now think about that. Out of all of the communities, not only in Central Texas and Texas that are incredible, but the entire nation, for us to be on any list is amazing. For us to be named in the top 20 is just stunning. And it is a direct result of the work that we've done over the last 7 years, and quite frankly beyond that, to improve the lives of our citizens. It's a direct result of the work that our school board does
on maintaining a very strong, well-recognized school system. It is a result of our development corporation. It has truly been a team effort to get us there. And had we not had all these things working together, I don't think we would have been recognized for the way we have been. But we're 3 years in a row being recognized by Money Magazine. We had another organization that eludes me off the top of my head. We were in the top 10 for families, for being a family-friendly city. And it all goes back to everything. I remember when I was a relatively new agent in Pflugerville. I'd been an agent 3 or 4 years. And I don't remember how the conversation came up, but we started talking about the makeup of our cities. I was with another number of other agents. And I described Pflugerville as we are a pure middle-class community, which worked very well for me because I'm just kind of a pure middle-class kind of guy. But I told him, I said, Pflugerville doesn't have any real low end, and we don't have any real super high end, but boy, we have got middle America, which if you're a State Farm agent, that's nirvana, because that's who we market to is middle America. And that's what Pflugerville is. We are good, everyday, high-value people. I tell people all the time, people move to Pflugerville because they get a better value here than what they get in many places. And so it's just worked out. It's worked out wonderfully from that standpoint.
And the demographics of the town, youth-wise and education-wise, it's a young town.
Our demographics are very interesting when you look at a suburb. A lot of suburbs have similar demographics to what we have from a youth standpoint, because a lot of suburbs are young families moving out, a little less expensive, better school systems in the urban core, that sort of thing. So we're a young community. We have, you know, Pflugerville, this is something you may not know, we have a higher percentage of patents than any city in Central Texas. So we have a very educated workforce, and not only that, we have a very industrious entrepreneurial workforce. But the thing I'm probably most proud of when it comes to our demographics is that racially we are very diversified, much more diversified than any of the suburbs around us. We float between 15 and 20% African American. We are around 35 or 40% Hispanic and Anglo, and then the rest being Asian and Indian and just a mix. But what that creates is this incredibly diversified community that we all make around the same amount of money because we're all just kind of middle America. So it works better than any place I've ever seen to have this diversity and to create these different ideas. In mine, I live in a small neighborhood of 55 homes. And in my neighborhood, there are people that have moved here from India, Pakistan, Nigeria, African-American, Hispanic, Anglo. I think that's all of it. But that's in 54 homes, we have that kind of diversity. So, and that's spread throughout our community, whether it's an established community or whether it's a brand new community being built in Falcon Point. People come to Pflugerville. And I talk to people, going back to the school district, I talk to a lot of people moving into town because of the industry I work with State Farm. And I can't tell you the number of people that have told me that they came to Pflugerville specifically because the school system is as diverse as it is. They wanted their children to be in a school system that looks like the rest of America, not a school system that was either all African American or all Hispanic or all Anglo. They wanted that diversity, and they've got it in Pflugerville.
We're going to talk about Deutschenfest for a
moment. Oh, yeah. I love Deutschenfest.
It's been a traditional event, uh-huh. Annual event. So tell us your perspective of Deutschenfest.
Well, Deutschenfest is my favorite weekend of the year by far. It is fun. I started going to Deutschenfest probably my first year in Pflugerville as a State Farm agent. I remember the chamber asking me if I would work their booth for a few hours. And I'll never forget that particular it was a Friday night. The first night of Deutschenfest, and a front blew through, and the temperature dropped by 30 degrees, and it rained and howled and kind of damaged Deutschenfest for that night. But that's my first memory of Deutschenfest, and then my next number of years, Deutschenfest occurred on the same weekend as the league I was the president of, the sports league, that we had an end-of-year tournament. So I didn't get to come to Deutschenfest too much. But then I had become a Rotarian in 2003 or 2004, I believe. And our Rotary group has a big beer garden that we set up every year at Deutschenfest. And so I started attending Deutschenfest really more as a worker and a volunteer than as a participant in Deutschenfest. And so for the last almost decade, I spend around 40 hours between Thursday evening and Sunday at noon pouring beer at Deutschenfest at our beer garden for the Rotary group. And it's our biggest fundraiser of the year, so I'm very invested in it, and we do incredible things through this club. But while I'm there and I'm at Deutschenfest doing a very German thing, which is pouring beer, I get to see all of my neighbors. I get to see the citizens of the city of Pflugerville. And it is so much fun when people walk up and they recognize me, or one person is there who's from Pflugerville and maybe they brought a friend from somewhere in Austin or Round Rock. And they'll say, oh, by the way, the mayor's pouring beer for you. And they always brighten up because people don't expect that. It's one of those things that makes Pflugerville unique, is that our leaders will get out and do that kind of thing. And not do it for a photo op. Be there for hours upon hours upon hours. Both Councilman Cooper and Councilman White, and Councilman Marshall have all been a part of the Rotary tent. Councilman White on the sausage end, and Cooper and Marshall on the beer end. None of them are Rotarians, but they already volunteer incredibly for their community, and yet they see another opportunity that's fun and that is giving back, and they say, "Hey, sign me up!" And so they'll stay there on a Saturday evening from 4 o'clock until midnight, and work their fingers to the bone and do it with a big smile, and you've got half the way. We have to be careful with quorum problems sometimes because so many of us up there are working.
There are numerous civic groups in town. Tell me what the Rotarians, the proceeds from this particular benefit, mm-hmm.
I can't talk about the Rotarians without talking about the Lions, because they're both incredible organizations. And I kind of call the Lions Club Old Pflugerville, and the Rotarians New Pflugerville. And they both have their place, and they both do incredible things. I know a lot more about the Rotarians because I am one. When I first joined the Rotary Club back in the early 2000s, for us to, you know, our primary focus is giving scholarships, and for us to give $3,000 in scholarships back to local seniors was a big deal for us. I was president of the organization actually when I was elected mayor in 2007, and that year I think we went from 3,000 to 6,000 in scholarships. And since then, I'm so proud of the club, is that over the last 5 years we've given well over $100,000 back in scholarships. Last year alone we did $34,000 just in scholarships, and those always go to PFISD seniors, whether that's Conley, whether it's Pflugerville High School or Hendrickson. And we couldn't do that without the support of the community. We have two primary fundraisers, Deutschenfest, which I was just talking about, and then we have a golf tournament. And we only have 40 members in our club. We give over $1,000 a year away per member. And we are not a club like in some very affluent areas where members just open up their checkbooks and write checks when money's needed. We're a club that gets out and works. Goes back to those middle America roots, the middle class roots that we have, and it makes me once again so proud to be mayor of this community.
I want to capture the Deutschenfest parade.
Uh-huh.
You have been in the Deutschenfest parade too many years, and yeah. Tell us what your role is, what you have.
Yeah, I'm so bummed. This will be my first parade to miss as mayor coming up this year. My daughter graduates from Texas Tech the same weekend, and I can't be in Lubbock and Pflugerville at the same time. My wife's told me I'm going to be in Lubbock, so I guess that's what's going to happen. The parade is fun, and the parade is mostly fun for me because of the fact that the city, and I, you know, I think it's been going 25 years or something, they have a mayor for the day and they have a coloring contest, and hundreds of children in Pflugerville do a color, you know, color a picture, and it goes to Dairy Queen and sits on their wall, and they judge who the best is, and the absolute best picture gets to be mayor for the day. And it's typically a first or a second grade boy or girl, and I announce who the mayor for the day is, and I get down on one knee and we take pictures, and I tell them, now the biggest thing you get to do as mayor of the day is ride with me in the convertible during Deutschenfest. And their eyes bright up, and I tell them, I'm gonna bring a bunch of candy and we'll drive down railroad and we'll throw candy, and I wanna make sure that you tell your teachers and your friends to be out there so that they can wave at you. And that is the highlight of those kids' year. They get to sit up there and wave, and we'll be driving down and they'll say, well, there's my friend, or there's my aunt and uncle, or there's my teacher. And it makes them feel so good. And you drive through and you're waving and you see your neighbors, and it just works really well.
And you have someone else driving your red truck.
I do. I always have. Typically, it's been my parents or my wife, because I'm driving in the convertible. And so I always have somebody drive. I have a 1950 truck that is bright red with State Farm on the side of it. And so that's my parade vehicle that I have in the parades. And it's fun. You know, being a 1950, there were a couple of years it hadn't made it to the whole parade, but we work on it and try to get it there.
Another interesting thing about our city is there is the neighborhood out, our neighborhood watch.
Mm-hmm.
Once a year, neighbors get together. You want to talk about that evening?
Trying to remember my statistics, third or fourth in the state for National Night Out in participation. The only community, and I've challenged Officer Dan to change this year, that has beat us is Cedar Park, and so we've got to do what we can in a friendly competition to beat them. Neighborhood Night Out is again one of those things that make us unique. You know, you hear about these kind of programs in other communities, and you might have pockets of participation where one particular neighborhood has a go-getter organizer and they'll organize something like this. Pflugerville, it's all over. It's not just one neighborhood. It is literally, we have 100 parties through our community, and it's designed to just meet your friends and meet your neighbors. And we have neighborhoods that rent bounce houses and DJs and do all kinds of stuff like that. We have other neighborhoods that don't do anything but put a table out with some literature. We had the one I went to this year had a live band at it, and everybody brought over their potluck, and I think it lasted till after 10 o'clock that night. So people take it and make it their own, but it has become an event. It is in some ways akin to the Super Bowl from a national perspective, where whether you like football or not in the United States, most people are going to go to a Super Bowl party. You know, a majority of people can go to a Super Bowl party and watch the game because it's become part of our national culture. Neighborhood Night Out has become part of our city culture. And it's just what you do in October. You have a night where you go out and you meet people. And you know, our crime rate has dropped 4 or 5 years in a row. Now, mind you, in that 4 or 5 years, we've grown from 40,000 people to almost 60,000 people. And our crime rate's dropping. Communities don't ever see that happen. It's happening in Pflugerville because of who we're made up of, what our culture is, and partly because people do get out and meet each other. And they care about each other, and they care about community. I've never been in an area that cares about community the way Pflugerville does. And it's not just people who have been in Pflugerville for the 50 years we've been here. It's people who have just moved to town. I have some new clients that moved into my neighborhood. They just moved here from Scotland. They have three little girls. And within weeks, they were in the Pflugerville culture. I saw on Facebook just last night, hey, I'm a new mom in town. I'd like to get together with other moms that have three-year-olds. another, and she said, I just moved here from Scotland. Somebody else said, well, I just moved here from Ireland and I have a three-year-old. So I immediately popped off. I didn't think the Irish and the Scots played well together. But it's that kind of community that's important, and it makes us very unique.
One of the brands or marketing is the PF. Mm-hmm. And we can see that from the Pflugerville family feeling to the fun. And we also have a group called Focona, which is, again, a volunteer group. But it, again, helps to bring our neighborhoods together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Focona is it's a group of all of the neighborhood representatives that come together to try to make sure that they can get information from the city out to their neighborhoods and project that out. And so hopefully that organization continues to do well and thrive and grow. It becomes harder and harder as people get busier and busier. And quite frankly, as things like social media start to take the place of some of those kinds of things, because people can get their information from different areas. So Focona has been around for a long time, and I think they'll just continue to thrive.
We're going to talk about the vision for the future of Pflugerville. You've done a lot, and you see things that need to be done immediately in the next two to 5 years, maybe 10 years, and out to the 50 years.
Well, about 18 months ago, I had to make a decision if I was going to run for a third term of mayor. And being a volunteer, it's as you know, it's taxing, and you spend a lot of time, and it actually costs you money in your real job. And my wife and I sat down and talked about, is it something that we need to do and that I want to do? Is there anything left for me to accomplish from the, because the we had the balls rolling that I wanted to see rolling. And I made a decision to run again because I felt like the next 3 years, and once again, this was before I was reelected in 2013, so 14, 15, and 16, I said, those 3 years will dictate what happens in the city of Pflugerville in the next 50 years. We were coming out of the economic recession, the Great Recession. The ball was rolling again, investment was coming again, people were excited, Central Texas was thriving. And I wanted to be a part of that, and I wanted to see where we were going. Last year, we had a visioning session with the council, and I said, okay, I want to make sure we're all still on the same page, because we are all maybe envious is the word of the northern metroplex of Dallas. Those communities offer wonderful services. They're high value. They're high quality. The Friscos and the Planos and of that area. And I said, are we still on the same page that we want to model Pflugerville's development in that direction? We want good, high-quality development up and down 130. We want strong, vibrant neighborhoods further out, et cetera. And the council unanimously said, yeah, that's the direction that we still think we as a community need to go. And so that's what we're striving for. You know, last week we announced a deal to create a 120-acre development called Pflugerville Crossing. It will change, in my mind, for the better Pflugerville's history and Pflugerville's future, I guess is the way to put it. It will have it'll be a mixed-use development where it has retail and residential and work all in the same place. It'll have something like 8 office buildings. It'll have something like 22 restaurants. It'll have entertainment venues. I'm hoping that there's a club or a neighborhood bar that goes into it. They're talking about putting what they're going to call a town center in, and there's a possibility at least that there may be some city offices there at some point. There may not be. The council hasn't made that decision, but it's going to be modeled after that because the developer understands creating that kind of an atmosphere is going to be wonderful. It's going to have a big green area for concerts and festivals and chamber events to be held on. It is going to be a wonderful economic engine for the city. We anticipate that over 30 years, all of the taxing entities that are involved will receive over $2 billion in additional revenue. And that's not counting the other growth that's going to occur, the ancillary growth because of it. Now, I pay a lot of attention to social media, because I get a real feel for what real people are thinking about, because they will say things on Facebook that they would never tell me in person. They would never, for whatever reason, be honest with me in person, but they'll say it on Facebook all day long. And so I get a lot of truth there, and I'm finding a very interesting mix about this particular development. The only significant negative that I keep hearing is that we're growing and that we're not going to be the small town anymore. And that's accurate. That's a fact. And the council talks a lot about that. I have a saying that we are a big little town, that we really work hard as a community through things like Deutschenfest and the Chili Festival and these communities, Neighborhood Night Out. We work really hard to keep a small town feel. We are next to one of the largest and fastest growing metropolitan areas in the entire United States. We have better transportation infrastructure than any community in Central Texas. There is no way for us to stop growth. It is not possible. We might be able to slow it down. There's no way we can stop it. But what we can do is we can control that growth in the direction that we think it needs to go. We can make sure it's high quality that's going to bring wealth to our community. That's what we're doing. That's what the city is doing. You know, as we stand today, we have 53 to 55,000 people that live within our city limits. Mind you, when I moved to Pflugerville in 2001, the sign said 16,600 people. In 2010, it said 35,000 people. When I was elected mayor in 2007, it was 35,000. We are growing exponentially. That growth is going to occur. But what's interesting is that is only a part of our story. Because of the way we've developed with municipal utility districts or MUDs, there are another 20,000 people that consider themselves Pflugerville, that think they live in Pflugerville, that call themselves Pflugerville, that aren't citizens of the city of Pflugerville. And our challenge is to love them and to make them feel like citizens and balance the services we give and the money we spend, because those people are spending money in Pflugerville. They are going to our shopping centers. They are working in our office buildings. And so our challenge is to stay little while we grow big and to have this almost a third of what I consider our residents live outside the city, still assimilate them into our city culture. Because we're only going to stay small if the majority of people understand that culture, and trying to bring them in is a huge deal. Our ETJ, as it stands today, we think our ultimate build-out, now whether that ultimate build-out is 30 years from now or another 50 years from now, we don't know, is 250,000 people. That is a stunning number to me. I grew up in a town of 250,000 people in Corpus Christi. And to think about the city of Pflugerville having that many people is amazing. And I tease all the time, that may not be the end. All the other Central Texas suburbs, or most of them, are already boxed in by either other communities or natural growth prohibitors. The city of Pflugerville can grow east as far as we want to grow east. I tease that we could grow to Katy if we wanted to. There's nothing out there, and we can grow as long as we can support the infrastructure for our citizens.
One of the things that happened as the population grew is Pflugerville received a seat on the Campo board.
Yes.
And you serve on that now?
I do.
Would you tell us just briefly a little bit about that?
I do. Campo is the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, and it deals with transportation dollars from the federal government, and we try to plan transportation needs. When I was elected, Pflugerville did not have a position on it, and I felt like it was important that we gain a position on it so that our voice is heard. And so for the last 5 years, we've had a position on it, and I sit there with the mayor of Pflugerville and the mayor of Austin, the city council members from all over Austin and mayor of Cedar Park and Round Rock. And it's just an organization of leaders from all over Central Texas. And we're trying to figure out transportation needs. But it's, you know, will Pflugerville get direct benefit from some of that? Sure. What's more important is Pflugerville's voice is heard. And that's what's exciting, because it goes back to what I've talked about, what I've weaved through this entire talk, is changing that perception for Pflugerville to have a seat at the table.
You've also been involved in public-public relationships and public-private partnerships that have helped to make the city accomplish what it's needed to do.
Mm-hmm.
Public-private is a fairly new concept in this area.
Well, most of our, you know, most of our incentive deals end up being some type of a public-private, especially if for this new Pflugerville crossing, if any portion of city business ever starts getting held down there, that would definitely make it a public-private. Hawaiian Falls was a huge public-private partnership. We actually, our development corporation purchased the land that the Hawaiian Falls is on, and they got a loan in their name, and then Hawaiian Falls leases that back, and the Hawaiian Falls, based on their first year, is going to do wonderful, and the city will never have to pay, the development corporation never have to pay a penny for that. But we once again saw something that we needed, and we created a partnership with somebody in the private industry to take care of it.
The last question is, on this 50th birthday anniversary mm-hmm. of the city of Pflugerville, is there a final comment you'd like to share with the citizens?
You know, this has been such an exciting time to be mayor, and we've grown so much. I can't wait to see what Pflugerville looks like 25 years from now, because it's going to be, the growth is going to be outstanding. And, you know, what I want to challenge future mayors and future councilmen to do is to keep Pflugerville what it is, which at its roots, we are a rural German community that loves families. And that makes us a small community. Doesn't matter whether we're 50,000 people or 100,000 people or 200,000 people. If we'll keep those cultural roots together and strong, we have the ability to stay that small town that we want to stay.
Okay. Thank you very much. If there's anything else that you haven't said that you want to say, now is your time.
Nope, I'm good. Happy birthday, Pflugerville.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
All good.
Good deal.